So this is Math 150, Section 1, lecture somewhere in the 20s, probably around 20, give or take a little bit. The first thing we're going to start with today is spherical coordinates. So we did polar coordinates before, and we did several different justifications for why polar coordinates work. Spherical coordinates is a little bit harder because there's now three things that are changing. Physics books and math books have a difference of notation in terms of, is the angle theta going around the xy plane, or is the angle theta coming down from the z-axis? In our book, we use phi to come down from the z-axis, and we use theta for the xy plane. The reason we do this is then you reduce things to polar coordinates, and in polar coordinates, you have theta in the xy plane. It makes a lot more sense. I agree it makes more sense. I learned it first from the physicists with theta coming down from the z-axis, so you always have to watch me. We talked about how the change of variable formula works, that we basically use these tangent plane approximations, and we take our point and we expand it out, and we did it in the two-dimensional case. All that would go on in the three-dimensional case is that you would have to now expand, instead of just u and v, u, v, and w. And you would get not a parallelogram, but a parallel pipette. And you would need to find the volume of the parallel pipette. And so you would use the determinant formula. Now, we have not done linear algebra right now, but we at least showed that the volume of the parallel pipette from, say, UVW is U dot V cross W. You know, this is the stuff from chapter 11 coming to save the day. And that was the same as the determinant of U1, U2, U3, V1, V2, V3, W1, W2, W3. To do the more general change of variable formula is going to be very challenging in Calc 3, as we don't have linear algebra, and we need to start talking about volumes of even larger dimensional objects than just a parallel pipette. But there is a notion of determinant. There's the idea that you just put the vectors in, and then you just calculate that determinant. One of the things we have to be careful about is when we're using the change of variable formula, it's always the absolute value of the determinant. So when we do the vertical lines here, that just means determinant. But typically, we use the absolute value of the determinant, and the matrix is often denoted as J for the Jacobian. We are not going to go too much into all the different notation and whatnot. So we said in polar, we've got dx dy goes with r dr d theta. And we knew that in that situation, we should really view this as dr times r d theta. And if we view it like that, we now have two lengths. Okay, so this is the general setup. What we want to do now is we want to figure out what should we do for spherical coordinates. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to write the spherical stuff down. I'm not going to go through the derivation as to why spherical is true. The final derivation we did for polar, where we expanded things out, you just do that a little bit more. Okay, so for spherical, we have x, y, and z. And we now have rho, theta, and phi. And so if this is the z-axis, the angle we come down here is phi. This length is rho. So the radius that's parallel to the xy plane is just going to be r equals rho cosine phi. So if you could just remember this little picture here, you can then figure out the rest of the stuff. We then get x is r cosine theta, and y will be r sine theta, just the polar coordinates. We already know what the theta is. We have to figure out what radius we plug in. And the radius we plug in is we reduce the radius from rho to rho cosine phi. And we get x is going to be rho cosine phi. Oh, I'm sorry, this is not cosine phi. What is it? It's not cosine phi, it's sine phi. So it's rho sine phi, that's its radius, times cosine theta. Y would be rho sine phi sine theta, and z would be rho cosine phi. And so that gives you X, Y, and Z if somebody tells you rho, theta, and phi. Theta goes from 0 to 2 pi, phi goes from 0 to pi, and then rho goes from 0 to whatever the radius is. So we need to figure out, if we have a dx, dy, dz, how does that correspond with d rho, d theta, d phi? Most of you, after you leave Williams, will never do a triple integral in spherical coordinates in the rest of your life. So the mechanics of this, and I know this is being recorded, is not the most important thing. What's important is right now, can you look at this and give me some idea of how the change is going to depend on rho, theta, and phi? One of the three variables I claim it's very easy to figure out what the dependence is, or at least it's much easier than figuring out the dependence on the other two. Which variable do you think is the easier one for the dependence? What are your thoughts? So you should know what the spherical change of variables is, and you should know what the determinant is. You know, you've watched the video, you've read the book, you know what the answer is. Knowing the answer and looking at this, which part do you think is the easier part to understand or to give an explanation for where it comes from? Any thoughts? So does anybody remember the answer? Yes. Yes. So which is the easier part, the rho squared, the sine of phi, or for theta, the fact that it's just 1? What are the units of dx, dy, dz? Were you raising your hand? Or?
Well, d theta is just 1, I guess, when you answer it.
Okay, why would that? Well, but why does the change of variable not involve any theta dependence? It involves a phi dependence and involves a rho dependence. So when we actually calculate the derivatives and we put them in the matrix and calculate the determinant, yeah, we see that it has rho dependence and phi dependence, but not theta dependence. And the rho dependence is rho squared. Why does rho squared look like good dependence? Like the dependence you would expect. What are the units of dx, dy, dz?
Meters cubed.
Meters cubed. What's the units of d rho, d theta, d phi? Meters. What must the rho dependence be? So what would the rho dependence have to be? Well, you know it's rho squared. Why does it have to be rho squared? Yes.
The units.
Yes, the only way the units work. I've got to get units of meters cubed. This is of units meters. It's got to be a rho squared. So this is the easy part, or the relatively easy part. It's got to be a rho squared. The sine of phi, that's the much harder part. The fact that it's 1 d theta, well, maybe that's similar to just the polar coordinates. And I've come how I reduced downward, so maybe, okay. I can kind of see why it might be a d theta, but the sine of phi is hard. What do you think the most common mistake is when you use spherical coordinates? Yes?
To have the sine of theta instead of...
Yeah, to have sine of theta rather than sine of phi. Here's a good way to see why it can't be the sine of theta. Let's look at the integral of 1, you know, dx, dy, dz over the sphere. What should that integral equal? So if I integrate 1 over the sphere, that should just be the volume of the sphere. If I use a sine of theta, so this will be a mistake. I will have, you know, phi goes from 0 to pi, theta goes from 0 to 2 pi, rho goes from 0 to r, rho squared sine of theta, d rho, d theta, d 60 feet. Well, the integral's all split, right? There's nothing like e to the rho theta, or cosine of rho theta. So I can write this as this is the integral, p goes from 0 to pi, and I'll just have d phi. And I have the integral theta goes from 0 to 2 pi of sine of theta, and then the integral rho goes from 0 to r, rho squared d rho. I can do all of these integrals, but one of these integrals is very interesting. Which integral is the interesting one here? Yes?
The sine of theta.
Yeah, what do you get when you integrate sine of theta from 0 to 2 pi?
0.
You get 0. If you approximately remember a formula, you can often figure out exactly what it is by testing it in a special case. I know it's either rho squared sine theta or rho squared sine phi. Which one is it? Well, let me calculate the volume of a sphere. I should get something positive. I'm getting 0. I've made a mistake. It's not sine of theta. So it's really good if you only approximately remember something, if you can test it in a case. So this is really good life advice. So now we know it can't be that, right? So let's get rid of the mistake. Let's do it correctly. Let's put a phi here. So now this is just going to be d theta, and this will now be sine of phi d phi. This is the advantage of being at the blackboard. Now we have three integrals that we actually need to do. So the sine of phi, what function integrates to sine of phi? I'm sorry, what's the integral of sine of phi? What function has derivative of sine of phi?
Minus cosine.
Minus cosine. So we get minus cosine of phi evaluated 0 and pi. Now we integrate d theta from 0 to 2 pi. So we would just get theta at 0 and 2 pi. And we would get rho cubed over 3 at 0 and r. All right, so negative cosine phi at pi is negative negative 1 is positive 1. Then we subtract off cosine of 0. So we subtract off negative cosine of 0. So this part is just 2. This part is 2 pi. And this part is r cubed over 3. So we get 4 thirds pi r cubed, which is the correct volume for the sphere. If this were not the case, we would have made a huge mistake. So always check your work on a simple case. So this is not a proof that we haven't made a mistake. But we did calculate the volume of a sphere by integrating, you know, the correct height over a circle in the unit plane. And in the Cartesian plane, and so we do know that the volume of a sphere is 4/3 pi r cubed. So we've at least calculated this before. This works. This is a good start. Okay. So this is spherical coordinates. The way all of these work, you know, spherical, polar, cylindrical, is whatever I give you, try to do it as the problem is posed, and if it's not working, try changing variables. Or try switching orders of integration. Those are essentially our only techniques. Now, there are three big coordinate changes. I've only given you two. Which is the one I haven't given you? Yes.
Cylindrical.
I haven't given you cylindrical. Why haven't I given you cylindrical? Yeah.
Because basically it's polar coordinates?
It's polar coordinates with z along for a ride. Right? So all cylindrical coordinates is, you know, z wants to play as well, fine, you can play. It's just r dr d theta dz. Right? So this would be something if you have what kind of symmetry for cylindrical coordinates? What kind of symmetry would you want to have if you want to use cylindrical coordinates? If you're afraid to say the answer because you think it might be too definitional, don't be afraid. What kind of symmetry do you like for cylindrical coordinates? What kind of shape do you want the object to have?
Cylinder.
Cylinder, right? The name is useful. What kind of symmetry do you want for spherical coordinates? spherical, right? These are good names. Polar coordinates. Circle, yeah, so the polar coordinates makes it a little bit hard, right? You could call it, circular coordinates, okay? All right, so now that we have this, let's go back and let's do the Newton shell problem. Let's try to show that if we want to calculate the force, it is equivalent if all of the mass is at the center. This is an integral worth doing. All right. There's a couple of ways of doing it. You guys get the advantage of seeing the thought process. So we will have theta goes from 0 to 2 pi. We will have rho goes from 0 to big R. And we will have phi goes from 0 to pi. So this is the angle phi coming down over here. This is rho. And I'm going to assume that I am R units from the origin. So we expect that the total force should be some constant divided by big R squared. And at each point on the sphere, we can calculate the force. Okay? And then we just integrate over everything. Now the question is, what is that? Well, let's call that maybe R. What could we use to find a good expression for little r? We used this last time. So we want to express r in terms of the things that come in the problem. Oh, wait a minute. I don't want to use r for both of these. Crap. Running out of letters. We'll do a unit sphere. We'll keep the notation down a little bit. We'll do a unit sphere. What way do we have to relate little r to big R, rho, phi, and theta? What relationship? So this is the hard part, is when you have a problem like this, when you have a word problem, what relationship do you have between the quantities? So you always want to see, how can I relate them? So any thoughts about relationships between them? So what kind of object is R part of? Yes.
Part of a triangle.
It's part of a triangle. So do we have anything that would give us, we have three sides of a triangle and an angle. Yes.
The laws of cosines.
The law of cosines. So R squared, which is great because that's, we want 1 over R squared, is equal to big R squared plus big rho squared minus 2 R rho cosine phi. So that will help. The next thing is, we need to know the cosine of this angle up here. So we need, let's use alpha for the angle. So we want to figure out what the cosine of alpha is, because that's how much we have to depress the force, right? The only part of the force that matters is the part that's pulling you down. Everything else is canceled. So let me draw the triangle again. So here's alpha. Here's phi. If you were to draw an auxiliary line for this triangle, which line would you draw? So what's your favorite kind of triangle? Yeah.
I would draw a line from the right end point over to the left side.
So if you draw something like this, you get a lot of right triangles. So this is R over here, this is rho over here, And this whole side length here is big R. So this is phi, this is 90, this is 90 minus phi. If this is 90 and this is alpha, this is 90 minus alpha. You know, just sometimes useful to just label the triangle, see what you have. Okay? So, if I take cosine alpha, that would be this length. And if I take rho cosine phi, I get this length. What should that sum equal?
Big R.
Big R. So we would get cosine of alpha is equal to R minus rho cosine of phi over little r. So there's lots of ways of relating things. You also have to worry about, well, what would happen if we were down over here? Or down over here? Then the r cosine alpha would get you all the way down to here. And now phi would be beyond 90 degrees. The cosine of phi would now be negative, and that would subtract, and the relationship will still hold. So the relationship will hold for all values. So it's not necessarily clear that this is the best expression for the cosine of alpha, but at least it's an expression. So, you know, what else could we do? You know, there's lots of different ways. We'll leave it like this for now and see if this leads to something that is tractable. The other things we could do is this length is R sine alpha, and it's also rho sine phi. So we also have a relationship like that. It makes sense that if I tell you what phi is, we know what alpha is. The other thing we could do is there's another way we could get a cosine alpha. How else could we get a cosine alpha? We could use the law of cosines again. So we would have rho squared is r squared plus little r squared minus 2rr cosine alpha. And so if we do that, we would get cosine alpha is r squared plus r, little r squared minus rho squared divided by 2rr. This is the hard part. This is why, to some extent, I enjoy giving this lecture more in section one than section two. Because right now, I don't know which way is best. I've deliberately not thought about this. By section two, I'm going to remember. Which do you think is going to be better? This expression for cosine alpha or this expression? May not be immediately clear. I mean, the nice thing is this doesn't seem to have any explicit angles, which might make things nicer. But this does have more little r's. This has an r squared up here. So it's not always clear which way is going to be best. All right, let's start doing the integration now. So we would want to integrate over the sphere. The force is going to be g. We'll say the mass up here is m1. We'll assume the density is 1, just to make things nice. Doesn't really matter. I don't want to use rho for density, so we'll just make the density 1. So we'll have g rho 1 divided by little r squared. We need the cosine of alpha. And now we need the spherical stuff, which will be times rho squared sine of phi d rho d theta d phi. And so rho is going to go from 0 to 1. Theta is going to go from 0 to 2 pi. is going to go from 0 to pi. So when we look at this, which integral is going to be the easiest integral to do? The rho, the theta, or the phi? Yes? Yeah, the theta. There's no theta dependence. We can just integrate the theta and get a 2 pi. Now, what's nice is for the phi and the rho integrals, they're both from, you know, 0 to something fixed independent of the other. We can do those in either order. We have the ability to switch orders of integration. So we can write this as, you know, 2 pi, then we'll have integral phi goes from 0 to pi, integral rho goes from 0 to 1. I'll pull out the g as well, so it'll be 2 pi g, and then we will have rho squared over r squared. And now we have cosine alpha. And now we have sine of phi d rho d phi. Now we have to start making choices. Yes?
Wouldn't we have m1 in the expression?
We don't have what? Oh, I dropped m1. Ah, yes, thank you. So now we have to choose what we want to do. Well, we know r squared is big R squared plus rho squared minus 2r rho cosine phi. So we have 2 pi m1g integral phi goes from 0 to pi, integral rho goes from 0 to 1. We have rho squared divided by r squared plus rho squared minus 2r rho cosine phi. Now we have to choose what we want to do for cosine of alpha. So which thought do you think is going to be better? Yes?
I think maybe the top one, because
okay.
There's no little r in that expression.
Well, it's in the bottom. They both have a little r in the bottom. This one has a cosine phi up here.
Yeah.
So big R squared is a constant. Rho squared is actually not that harmful to us, right? Because, you know, the rho integration is not too bad. I might try the bottom. And so then we would get from the cosine of alpha, let's make sure this stays in focus, this is starting to get a mess, we will then get r squared plus little r squared minus rho squared over 2 big R, and then little r, well, this is little r squared. So we would have this to the 3/2 power. Right? Because the square root of that would be little r. We already had it to the first power. So this would now be to the 3/2 power, and we would have d rho d phi. Okay? So now this is the integration we need to do. And I dropped the sine of phi. Do you like the sine of phi? What do you think? I dropped it, I added it back. Are you sad I dropped it? Are you happy I added it back? Do you wish I had dropped it and it wasn't there? Or is it making your life better? Yes?
It could be making our lives better because you might be able to do a U substitution.
Ah! So if you look down in the bottom, which integration would you like to do first? Would you like to do the rho integration first? Or the phi integration first? Yes.
The
vo. Why would you like to do the vo integration first? I'm sorry, it would be. Well, you got a 50-50 chance. So the question is, what is there in this problem that makes the rho integration attractive? So the problem is down here, we have a 3/2 power involving an r squared plus rho squared minus 2r rho. So if you're going to do the rho integration, you would need to find an antiderivative of this. So I've got this massive mess down below. So because of that, I think the rho integration is going to be hard to do first. If I looked at the bottom, if I had this whole thing as u, if I regard this basically as a phi problem, what's the derivative of cosine phi?
Negative
sine phi. In fact, we even have a negative cosine phi. So when we take the derivative of that, the phi integration looks like it could be very tractable. So if we go back, let's try to do the phi integration first. So if we do the phi integration first, then what we're going to do right now is we're going to fix a rho, and we'll have the integral phi goes from 0 to pi. I'm only going to care about the phi part. So I would have down below r squared plus rho squared minus 2r rho cosine phi to the 3/2. And then sine of phi d phi. Then everything else we'll worry about later. Let's just try to do the phi integration. So this is one of the reasons why I really like this problem. There's a lot of good integration here. It's a way to review stuff from Calc 2. All right? So if I want to take the derivative, and the antiderivative of this, right? What would I love to have upstairs? I wouldn't want sine of phi. What would I love to have? So we don't just have a cosine phi down below. We have a minus 2r rho cosine phi. So I would love to have, I think, a 2r rho up here. And then I would put a 1 over 2r rho over here if I want to do my u substitution. Yes?
Wouldn't you want a negative 2r
rho? Nope. Because what's the derivative of cosine?
Right. Okay.
So
if I let...
So we've got to decide how we want to do this. If I let u be r squared plus rho squared minus 2r rho cosine phi. I can let u be the whole thing. What would du be? It would just be 2r rho sine phi d phi. Right? And so phi goes from 0 to pi. What does u go from? When phi is 0, what's the cosine of 0? So we get r squared plus rho squared minus 2r rho. Oh, what's r squared plus rho squared minus 2r rho? So we have r squared plus rho squared minus 2r rho. Yes? How can we view this? How would you simplify this algebraically? You can leave it like that, but r squared plus rho squared minus 2r rho simplifies. Yes?
R minus rho squared.
R minus rho squared. How did you see that?
when you fold it up, you really want to write this as r squared minus 2r rho plus rho squared. The hardest part of all this is the algebra. It's not written in the standard way. If it's written like this, is it more obvious that this is r minus rho squared? It's the same thing over here. You need to know that I should rearrange things. This is the hardest part of really mathematics and science. You can do the trained work. It's how do you get yourself into a position where you can do the trained work. So the lower bound is going to be r minus rho squared. And then the upper bound is when phi equals pi, what's the cosine of pi?
Negative 1.
So this becomes a plus here, this becomes a plus here. So this goes up to r plus rho squared. And so now what do we get? We now get 1 over 2 r rho integral u goes from r minus rho to r plus rho. We have a du over u to the 3 halves. Is that correct? Yes?
Wait, shouldn't the bounds be r minus rho squared?
Yeah, you should. And in fact, we should be excited about the fact that the bounds involve squares because we have something to a half integer power. So when we integrate it, we'll have something to a half integer power. The squares will reinforce nicely. So this would then just be 1 over 2 r rho. Then we have a u to the negative 3 halves. So that should become negative a half u to the negative half.
Negative 2.
Negative 2, okay. Even better. Negative 2. So we get a negative 2 u to the negative 1 half evaluated at r minus rho squared and r plus rho squared. The 2's cancel. The negative sign flips the order. And so we get 1 over r rho. And then since we're flipping the order, we get 1 over r minus rho minus 1 over r plus rho. Does that look correct? Okay. All right, so I'm going to hope at this point we do not need any of the stuff in the middle of the board, that we've passed the point of using these. So things will either work out now or they won't. So we are left with 2 pi m1g. We have an integral rho goes from 0 to 1. We have a 1 over r rho. Then we have a 1 over r minus rho minus a 1 over r plus rho. That actually does simplify. If I combine these things, I get r plus rho minus r minus rho. So the r's cancel. And you would get 2 rho over r squared minus rho squared. And now what was left over, we have, the only thing that was left is, we already handled all of this, we have the r squared plus, little r squared minus rho squared over 2r. So r squared plus r squared minus rho squared over 2r d rho. How does that look? It's possible we've made a mistake. Oh, wait a minute. Now I'm worried as to whether or not we made a mistake. Because little r actually has phi dependence. So did we not include that? So this would only give us
That would be correct for this term. For that term, it would be okay. But we forgot that the R over here has P dependence in it. So we would have to then go back and include that R squared. Well, that R squared will actually not be too bad. We had an R to the 3/2. That'll just give us an R to the 1/2 upstairs. So while we made a mistake, and the mistake is bad, it's actually not that challenging in terms of the work we need to do. We can actually go back and fix it without too much trouble. And what happens is, you'll see that there's a really nice cancellation. The R squared minus rho squared and the R squared minus rho squared are going to perfectly cancel. The rho is going to perfectly cancel. And we're going to be left with a big R squared over there. So we're going to be left with some constant divided by a big R squared. Great. And then all we have to do is go back and now put in that extra R squared term. Right? There's not time to do that and get it correctly right now, but there is time to just briefly go back and see what we've done here. Yeah, this is an integral worth doing. When you have integrals like this, you will almost surely make some mistakes. Where did we make the mistake and why? You know, I forgot about the little r. Nobody yelled at me. You caught all the other mistakes I made today, which is great, but nobody caught that one. So it's worth thinking, why didn't we catch the fact that this had phi dependence? When I write my bounds of integration, what do I always do? Yeah?
You write like phi equals zero.
Why do I do that?
Just let you know like what variable you're...
When I write here, what I should really be doing for this problem is write r, it's a function of little r, oh, sorry, big r of rho and phi. If I were to write this for little r, I don't think we would have forgotten it. And so, you know, I did not do this deliberately. I did not design this class to deliberately make the mistake here. It is something I would do. I did not choose to do that. But it really highlights how important it is to have notation where you can look and see what's going on. And by writing it like this, I do forget that it does depend on phi. And this is one of the most common mistakes. So, you know, you could either say that, you know, I feel better, you know, even, you know, tenured math professors make mistakes in problems like this, or I'm not getting my money's worth at Williams. You know, either one of those views is acceptable right now. You know, you're not going to get everything right 100% of the time. But can you find what your mistake is? Can you see, is it reasonable? What I like is we'll already see that this is looking really good. Okay, I'm going to stop recording now.